bienvenidas, bienvenidos to everybody who made the time to join us here today. It is a very special day, but first of all, let me introduce myself. I am Ana Flores, and I am the founder and CEO of WeAllGrow Latina. So as you know, tonight's event is brought to you in partnership with Audible. We'll be having a conversation about creating and performing scripted audio and the new Audible original show, Loops. Loops, let me tell you about Loops. It's a modern mystery crime supernatural audio drama as told through found audio that focuses on the story of an American businesswoman, which is played by Vivica A. Fox, who befriends a woman named Lupe, played by Teresa Ruiz, who's here with us today, who has experienced some serious trauma. While trying to find those responsible for causing Lupe's trauma, they start seeing clues that are indicative of something more sinister going on with Lupe, the perpetrators of the crimes against her, and the local government. So before we start tonight's conversation, why don't we hear a preview of Loops, which released on June 3rd.
You're a reporter, aren't you? How can I trust you?
That's how trust works. You don't know that. To trust anyway.
Then why don't you start asking questions?
So Diana, thank you for moderating today's conversation, and please join me up on the stage and I'll let you take it from here.
Thank you so much, Ana. It's a pleasure to be here with all of you tonight and here and chatting with these amazing mujeres. We're really excited to share the story of Loops and have you all go on this journey along with us a little bit. All right, so let's get to it. Let's start with Ana and Adelina. I want to preface this as we talk about Loops. We heard a little bit about what kind of story it is. It's very different. But let me preface the question by explaining for those who may not have listened yet that Loops is an audio drama. So it's not exactly what most people may know as a traditional audiobook listening experience. It's much more like a show for your ears. There's a cast, there's sound design. It's told in a very innovative format, which is in found audio. So I'd love for you to start us off by talking about where did you get this idea for this amazing story? What are the origins? And you know, tell us what you were thinking, what led you to create this audio story?
I'll go ahead and begin since the story was first something that Migrante Media, that's I'm half a Migrante, the other half is Jose Marquez, was sort of tasked to do. And the first thing we knew is that we were going to be producing a story for audio. So it all begins with sound. When you're listening, you cannot see what's happening and you're kind of a vulnerable, maybe scared and maybe searching for clues. So we thought, okay, all of that already leads itself to an interesting audio experience because when you're listening but not seeing, you are slightly vulnerable, but really just kind of paying attention. So then the opportunity to listen to a person or a character or someone who you would normally not listen to because of the way that they look is all of a sudden removed, right? So that lends itself for us to begin thinking of what kind of character we could come up with that would give us an opportunity to listen to them carefully. And so shortly after that, we began thinking about what kind of mystery, what kind of horror, what kind of genre we wanted to tap into and the kind of stories that perhaps made us cringe. And so through our research, we sort of came into thinking about the sort of, you know, the horror that many Latin American women in particular in border regions have been living through and how we could figure out a way to tell a story perhaps from that angle. But mostly we did some research looking into the research that this academic in Mexico had done and through her, we began to piece together this idea that it's mostly that a lot of the violence that is suffered is not so much because of machismo, but because of a society that has decided to sort of overlook or has no longer, that is excusing certain behaviors. And so we focus, we zeroed in on that society and what that society did. And so in sort of a long way, that's how we came to the beginning of trying to write the story of Lupe.
That's fascinating. Thank you. We're going to talk more about that sort of real world overlap and some of those themes that come in just a little bit. But first, I want to hear from you, Adelina. Did you know what you were getting into when you got into this project? Were you thinking audio first?
I was not thinking at audio at all. And as I have told Ana and Jose numerous times after the initial meeting where they talked to me about the project and this incredible idea that they had already been developing, I feel like I am the lucky queer tia who got to participate in making the monster baby and helping to birth it and in different ways. And for me, it's probably one of the most exciting artistic projects that I participated in, not just because of the themes and the story and the people we had a chance to work with, but because it is an audio drama. And I just kudos to Migrante Media for really believing in our audiences. I think a lot of time with Latinx audiences, the stories get dumbed down, watered down, and they just challenge you from the start. And then the actors, Teresa included, bring it on. So if you're open to this kind of mystery and story, the ride is phenomenal. So I just feel very fortunate to have learned so much, and I hope it's not my last audio project, or you know, that it's not the last that we'll hear of Migrante Media, no pun intended.
Thank you. Teresa, I'm gonna dive in with you for a little bit here. I'd love to hear from you what attracted you to the story and to the role, and then what was different or the same about working in audio versus film?
Well, the story touches upon the femicides that happen all throughout Latin America, but all throughout the world, I think. And that's a topic that's always been very important to me. I grew up in Mexico, and I moved to the border. I moved to Ciudad Juarez and around, maybe it was 1999, 2000. And that's when the topics of the murders of women was really heated. So I grew up in this reality. And to me, it is a subject that I actively look to talk about. So when I got the book, and I read that this theme was intertwined, and then I wanted to do it. Also, it happened during quarantine. I think it was like the toughest month, or like the first lockdown, and it was really great to have it because there was so much uncertainty. So that it was really great to have that creative outlet and to be creating this as the world was, you know, stopped and everything was closed down. And I was in a small town in Mexico. So we had to look for an engineer to record me there. So it was also made from like the local people in that town. At least my voice was recorded and made by that. So that was also very exciting for me, because usually you do it in the mainstream cities, but to me it's great when you get to work with local people in any way.
That's so exciting. I didn't realize that.
Yeah.
And such a great, yeah, you know, experience. We did hear a lot about that in working through COVID when we were still able to get into mm-hmm. our studios and people are able to record on their own. So I'm glad that you brought that up, and especially, you know, how it was an outlet for you.
Yeah.
During that tough time. So you talked about, you know, some of your personal connections to it as well, where you grew up mm-hmm. and the issue of femicide. Even though this story is supernatural and mystery and thriller, and as you referenced, Adelina, pure entertainment from the minute you hit play, right? There are those real world issues in it. There's political issues, the corruption that we see, unfortunately, through a lot of Latin America, and the social status of women that you mentioned, Ana. I'd love to hear you all talk about that a little bit more, about weaving that into the story, and just what it was like as you were working on this topic that was, you know, both entertainment and also some very hard-hitting real world issues.
Adelina, why don't you start this time?
Sure, and then I will quickly defer back to you as well. You know, I want to say that the real world issues, and I agree wholeheartedly con Teresa, exist because partly what the work itself was trying to weave in, right, which is this really astute, brilliant critique of capitalism that Jose had talked to us about, like when we were talking about the systems. And while we can have these really important themes in our works, I think what was clear to us from the beginning as creators is that if you want to get messages across as artists, the craft of the art has to be entertaining. It has to seduce the audience in many ways. So we knew what was the political framework and the groundwork, you know, and on top of that, it was, how do we make this integral to the characters that we're putting at the forefront of the story? And I think that that's why it's so critical to have had an actor, right, like Teresa, who came knowing the area from Texas, because similarly around that time period, 2000, 2001, is when I became familiar with what was happening from the Lourdes Portillo film, or later the novel by Dr. Alicia Gaspar de Alba and other writers. And then to think that we are in 2021 and that those issues that seem to be contained only to Juarez El Paso are now everywhere and have been ongoing, right? It goes back to, how do we tell a story where you're so engaged with what the characters desire and what they're going after that by the end of the ride, you realize, wait a minute, I've just been given a lesson in why all of us have to step up. Because this is not just happening in Mexico, right? Here in the United States, over Memorial Day weekend, 14 young Indigenous women went missing from South Dakota. So it's very real. And I can say that, but most people might go, eh. But then you give them a story that pulls you in and makes you laugh and makes you cringe, makes you hopefully cry and feel. Then you walk away with I think your corazón open, which is for a lot of storytellers and actors, the manda. Ana?
Can I chime in on that?
Yeah.
No, it's just so I don't lose my train of thought, but I think that when we created at least the part that I voice, which is Lupe, a lot of it was to create the joy and the, so when I was in El Paso and Juarez, I got to know a lot of the mothers, a lot of the activists that had lost their children. And a lot of what they found in me, because I was so young, is that I was able to live my dreams, that I had a hope and an opportunity for a life that their children didn't. So a lot of what we put in Lupe was a lot of that joy and innocence and fun. And it was very important to us to create that character in a way that could relate to whoever was listening, even through the voice, which was very different for me because it was just through my sound. But I think also just another idea that Adelina was saying is when it was 1999 or 2000 when everything exploded, and it was as if Juarez and the area of El Paso or the border kind of served as it's really funny because I just read this book about the same subject where it said that 20 years ago, the mothers from Ciudad Juarez and El Paso walked to Mexico City telling them what was happening. And now it is the people from Mexico City that are walking back there, kind of saying how everything blew up in everyone's faces. And now it's just all over the country and it's all over Latin America. And it's become a subject that it's just very important to talk about. I think the first movie I did about the subject was Border Town back in 2006. And it seems that today that I do loops, it's even worse, you know? So it's really important to keep reminding and to keep remembering where we are.
That's so true. And again, a reason why Teresa was our perfect Lupe. But one of the things that I also want to bring back and remind Adelina and everyone else about loops is that, as I started saying, that the first thing we thought about was what happens when you can only listen to something, then your body disappears, right? And when your body disappears, we're almost all the same. The issue with loops is that our bodies, their bodies, in this case, we're talking about two female bodies, one that is hurt and damaged. And the second body, in this case, Tori, is an African-American lesbian, right? So these bodies become the issue of this story where their bodies have power structures that are making it difficult for them to be who they are. So when we set out to do the story of loops, we knew we wanted to come up with some sort of superhero with a supernatural element where, even though Lupe was a victim, but this victim would become the hero. And with that transformation, we would learn of the power that this character had. Now, the only thing that we wanted to make sure to have in this character and to bring it again to real, to a kind of reality, a kind of belief that is personal to Jose and I in this case, is that it needed to depend on others for its success. So it didn't contain its own power, its own magic, but it was only through that other person's trust, through that person belief in the victim, through the fact that reluctant helper could walk with and witness not just the greatness of Lupe, but its weakness, and still remained a friend, had something very special for us that we wanted to make sure was at the core of the relationship. Ultimately, this Loops is a story about two women. And as I said before, their bodies, right? One hurt one that is hurt and abused, and another that is a lesbian woman, are both in this story mistreated, misunderstood, but most importantly, they are part of a society that sees them as immoral. So through this angle of trying to examine these bodies, we begin to see how society structure their entity. And so they have that in common, and we're hoping that other people can find also something in common with their bodies. Because at the end of the day, what we really set out to do is to kind of reframe or question what happens to our bodies in a capitalist system, or in a system that views some bodies worth more than others.
That's something you mentioned when we were talking about the story in the beginning, and you know, the value or the worthlessness. That's even a line actually that from Teresa's character about the worthlessness. So it is definitely that journey that we take about the physical bodies, the supernatural bodies. With that though, it's not about, she's a victim, but there's also a really key theme about empowerment. And you all talked about that empowerment and transformation. So I want to hear you talk about that a little bit more, and as well as the theme that's underlying here in these characters. They are more than one thing. They are more than meets the eye. They are more than maybe what the outside world sees them, as you were talking about their body. And that, I think, touches on the very topical and relevant theme of intersectionality. So if you can talk about that, the empowerment theme, and also what does intersectionality mean to you in your lives and in this story? Maybe we can start. Well, whoever wants to start. Who wants to start?
Teresa hasn't started.
Well, I think I like the word transformation a lot more than I like the word empowerment. just because empowerment feels like a lot of responsibility for a woman. I feel like there's a lot of talk about that lately, and it's a word that's thrown around all the time in every context. And to me, I just feel like, oh my God, I am so tired already just from hearing that. So I think that experiences or just living in the world will transform you either one way or another. And to me, that's a little bit more freeing. So I think that's what happens to Lupe. I think she becomes more of her, or gets closer to her true core. You know, I think that that's something that we all women that are walking this, I don't even know how to call it, but that are in this society and that are fighting through it, that happens to us, right? And in that sense, I think intersectionality should always be the basis of feminism. I think it's a subject that is talked about a lot in certain circles, but I don't think that in the general conversation about feminism is something that is at the forefront yet. So that is something that I always try to talk about. So, I mean, just in case nobody knows what intersectionality is, but it is to start by the bottom or the less privileged of women, you know, and then from there build up as opposed to down. So I don't know if Adelina or can help me.
No, I mean, you're absolutely right. And first I want to echo that I love that Teresa brought up the word transformation, because it connects to what Ana was talking about earlier. At the end of the day, we have a story about this friendship that occurs over this period. And as she said earlier, this unreluctant character. And partly why that's important is because if we're talking about intersectionality, which it makes me think of Kimberly Williams Crenshaw, who coined the term, and it's appropriate that she was a Black critical race theorist. It's appropriate that the Black Combahee collective of lesbians articulated in the 60s and 70s, that if you think about us, and I'm saying these Black queer bodies, and you start your social justice movements from there, then we all become free. And I think that what Lupe does for Tori is that she helps to transform her. And so we have to remember that easy alliances are not a given between women of color, queer or non-queer, and that you see this even in the story, and that what Lupe offers up to Tori is also the possibility for enlightenment towards the end. And it doesn't mean that they're not going to suffer in their own way, but I think that it points exactly to why intersectionality matters, is that, I mean, just looking at, you know, this little four square here, que tenemos, all of us are bringing our embodied experiences, whether it's around race, ethnicity, sexuality, a class, national status. And when we can start to see people as whole individuals with these complexities and connect those issues to the larger systems, then we begin to understand the value of intersectionality, as Teresa was saying. But the story, by virtue of who these characters are, is going to put that front and center. You have a Black lesbian, masculine of center presenting at that, you know, which gets treated differently from femme lesbianism. And you have this, you know, Latina young mujer who's, I don't want to give too much because you should listen to the story.
But also that belongs to a certain social class that has a certain kind of skin color, you know, that has all this, what do you call it, aspects that put it at a certain disadvantage. And also to a certain propensity that these things happen to her. That is very important.
Exactly.
I think, not to add too much, because you've both already said said plenty and beautifully, and more specifically how intersectionality may be presented in this story is almost always through their experiences with the different institutions. And very generally, you know, when they go to the church or when they go to the police station or when they go to a hospital, and you get to hear, the struggle that they have to go through to communicate in this world, and how they are seen is often something that we were very, very aware of, and wanted to make people understand that part of what they're suffering is really their existence in the world in their forms, right? We come back to the bodies, and these bodies that have to live in these spaces that are sometimes not nice to them. And through those experiences is how we're trying to talk about these differences. And as Teresa was mentioning, and something that we also wanted to bring, is what happens, you know, when you are dealing with biculturalism or multiculturalism, if you will, but where certain codes differ, where something that is seen as normal or acceptable for one may not be for the other. And so in this story, we try to bring those differences and those sort of findings and those experiences and those things that both Lupe and Tori are sharing together, so that we can explore them through our ears.
I also very quickly just want to commend Ana and Jose as producers, because none of us here are Black individuals. They also brought in Sonia Perriman as a story consultant, and they brought in Cheryl Ross as a co-writer in the process. So I think it's important, as we're talking about production, the value of having those voices, and they did that as producers. And I think that that's a testament to trying to get the most accurate and complex characterization possible of Tori.
That is great. Thank you so much. Time is flying here, and I want to make sure that we leave some time for our audience to ask some questions as well. So one more thing for you all, moving away a little bit from the story, but just for those who are listening might be interested in getting into the fields that you're in, and into entertainment, into arts, into acting, performing. So I'd love to hear you all just give a piece of advice on how, you know, somebody, a young Latina, Latinx, might enter this field. What would you advise that they do now? And then we can open it up to some questions.
For me, I'm going to say always quickly, it's good to have some arts background, performing arts or theater arts, because it taps into what it is to work within, you know, creative spheres. It allows you to criticism, both giving it and receiving it. And then go and if you can't get your job, the thing that you want, go take classes. UCLA has wonderful classes. I took the certificate for producing there, and I definitely learned quite a lot, even though I had already done some sound editing and video editing. I still wanted to do more. So luckily, well, if you have access to media classes, take them, but don't forget to also check into art.
Adelina?
Sure. I would say that I always follow Gloria Anzaldúa's manda, which is to do work que vale la pena. And that if you begin your artistic career knowing that you want to make a difference by telling stories and playing characters that are going to show the complexity of our lives as Latinx people, that's a wonderful way to always anchor yourself and to be reminded that there is, in art, there is no one road to get there. It's a long game, it's a marathon. So if you stay true to your vision, and as you do, as Ana says, you work at your craft and you find your cadre of people who are going to support you, other artists who are going to love you enough to be like, ¿sabes qué, Ade? I like that story, pero Lendi no, como que no sirve, right? So you need honest, loving feedback so that you can continue to grow.
And Teresa?
I think above all, you need faith, because since we are, at least Latinos are not, or Latinx are not, we're not so represented, or we haven't been historically, it's hard to believe that you can succeed, that you can become a successful artist, that you can live off of this, that you can have a great life. It's just hard to believe it because you don't see it that often. And so it's easy to drop out. it's easy to lose faith. It's easy to listen to the voices of whoever is antagonizing you, whether it's your family, friends, whatever. I think it is important to continue to walk the journey with faith and with joy, because opportunities always do present themselves somehow. And the sad part is to see that there, that once that happens, you are not ready. Not because you didn't want to be, but because you couldn't believe it because of this society that we have lived in. So it's important that we take that stance and that we move forward with faith and with joy.
Wonderful. Thank you all so much. I think I agree, representation is so important. I'm so happy that we're all here to do that. And with that, I want to open it up to a few questions. We have Jessica Serrano first. If you can unmute yourself or come on camera, we'd love to see you.
Hi, hello, ladies. Hi, my question is for Anna and Annalena. Just, you guys express such passion for the character in Loops, and I was just wondering, for what other stories would you guys like to tackle and move forward with in the future?
Anna.
Adelina, vale.
You know, I am interested in telling stories because of who I am in the world. I tend to put my artistic energy behind two-spirit LGBTQ characters because within the larger Latinx community, we're still in the margins, which of course you can imagine my excitement when Ana and Jose said, wait, there's a lesbian at the center of this. And I was like, I may be able to have a help with some of the details in this mundo. And the reason for that is because we're still dealing with the sexism, the homophobia, and the transphobia. And we, you know, we have very funny lives. They're not all dramatic. So echoing about joy, like the world has yet to understand what it means to be fully queer in this world and how it liberates, you know, non-queer folks. Because if you leave our bodies alone, hopefully you leave the bodies of women alone, and men and women can then, and non-binary people exist in ways that our stories can challenge what it means to be human.
For me, Jose and I work together. We work closely on a lot of stories, and we already have many stories of really just fascinating characters of all kinds of Latinx and Latines experiences, from the Cuban American to the Dominican. It's just a little bit of everything because of how we operate, how we work. But I think at the core of more of most of the stories that we come up with, or the ones that we are attracted to, oftentimes they're young female characters. And I'll tell you, the reason that we are often attracted to these characters is because probably the same reason we're all here, because the potential for transformation and growth is so real that it's very easy to build around this explosive moment where these characters are just ready to change. And ultimately, when you're telling stories, if that arc, right, which is what we learn, if that arc is easy to read and believable and everybody can taste it, then it makes that story really exciting. But in general, most of our characters are female, most of them, not all. And we have a ton of stuff that that I would love to be able, hopefully, to share more. But we have a Chicanita that was deported in Tijuana, and we have one that's based on the failed space program in Cuba, and it's a scientist in Cuba, and just the list goes on.
Thank you, Jessica. I have some fun questions. I can do a quick lightning round.
Oh yeah.
Wow. All right. So I'm going to ask you to fill in the blank on these, and we'll just go around the squares here. The food that says home to me is food that reminds you of home.
Fideo.
Fideo.
What reminds you of home?
Yeah, a food that reminds you of home. What is it that you, as soon as you smell it, you just think, oh, look, that is home.
Pasote.
All right, we've got, if I were a character from a book or a movie, I would be. Anybody, if you were.
Oh my God.
Or a movie.
Spider-Man.
Why Spider-Man? Gotta hear that.
Porque me encantas la little spiders, but the fact that I could just go into buildings and use my web, and if I hear someone speaking trash, I could just go, yeah.
I think I'd be just any character from Cien Años de Soledad. So I could just live in that town and just stay there.
Amazing. Do we have anybody?
I'm going to have to say Princess Mononoke. I love that animation and I see it over and over with my kids and I just love her character.
That is fun. Since we talked so much about characters and about intersectionality and representation, I'd like for you to fill in the blank on this one, please. People don't think of me as blank, but I totally am.
Indigenous.
Introverted.
Oh. I was going to say maybe because of all sort of the modern cliches that I'm probably more known for, people don't think of me as a romantic fool, but I am such a romantic fool.
That's great.
So I'll go ahead and ask Priscilla's question. Priscilla Levette is actually a published romance novel. She's a Latina romance novel. Yeah, she's based in Florida, so a lot of her her books are actually based in Florida. So she's asking, for writers looking to target Audible, how was it different writing an original for Audible versus writing a novel? Would you say it's closer to script writing?
I'll start by saying that writing for sound is very difficult because I'll preface it by saying that, and maybe adding a little bit by the difference when you're writing for film or a visual medium versus Audible, is that even with the visual, you can always show action, you can show many things, and possibly if somebody's reading, then they're already reading what you're describing. But when they're only listening and you need to describe a world or describe an action, the challenge is very, very different. Your brain has to almost like rework itself so that you can only think in a completely blind world.
Thank you. Anybody else want to talk about the experience of audio?
I want to talk a little bit about the experience of, it was the first time that I worked on Zoom. So that was really interesting. Vivica Fox was in her home doing the Zoom. And then we had Jose Adelina. And yeah, we had like a box with all of us. And it was really like the first time I ever did it. It helped that it was only through voice, so we could listen to each other. And it was amazing how we were able to connect through a screen. Now we do it more often, but back when we first did it, it was so new. It was really scary.
It was scary for us too. It was scary for us because I think in production, you have a larger staff of people that can help you in that moment with your talent or with technical stuff. But when you're sort of, everybody's in a bubble, and if anything goes wrong, and even if it's just about addressing a moment or a change or a direction,
you're not there, and it's not as easy to break away. So we realized quickly that this production was not like our old productions, and that, you know, the limitations we were feeling were also affecting our time, and they were affecting, you know, what we thought, our expectation of what we would get. But yeah, we got through it. It ended up being a lot more recording than we had expected, and partly that was because to really dedicate ourselves to one voice and to be there for that one voice was simply to just focus. Because at first we thought that capturing interactions would be to our benefit, since we needed breath, we needed a lot of breaths, and we needed a lot of emotional thing, but it ended up being a challenge. So as Teresa said, it was new for us too, and a learning experience for sure. But at the end, we got through it, and we have everything we need, and it just, everything just sounds awesome.
So to that note, there's one more question. I'll also take it because they're having issues with that. Joanna Carpio, so I think this is more about performing. So Teresa, any recommendation for modulating better? I am trying to start a podcast, but I always speak too fast.
Oh no, they just saved me. I really was just doing whatever I would do in a live performance and just trying to focus the energy on my voice, but it's really new to me. I think there's a lot of, I have training in voice, but it's more for theater. So voice work and audio is something that I'm starting to explore. And I think it's really interesting.
I'll add that for an audio play, like the one that we produced, it is highly produced. I think the most time of all the time was spent on the editing, because every little word was handled and polished and placed perfectly. So even though we got wonderful performances from all our voices, and we have a variety of voices, we took painstaking care in placing everything right where we needed it, so that the emotion was consistent, the time we needed, the delivery was consistent. And so I think for scripted podcasts, you're going to find that there's a lot of time placed on editing.
I'll offer up to the person who asked the question that a really good exercise that one of my maestras taught us way back in the day, if you needed to slow down when you were speaking, was to actually stand up and say your line while trying to walk backwards. And what it teaches you, because it tricks your mind into saying like, wait, what am I doing? It forces you to pay attention. And so it's one way to think about changing the pace. So there are these little tricks in the world of teatro that a lot of folks can borrow, but that's a good way to just work with slowing yourself down if you tend to speak very quickly. And, you know,
I mean, in Mexico, they'll put a pencil in your mouth and then they'll let you talk like that.
Oh, mira, there's another one.
It's great. Well, I believe we are coming up at time. I do see one last question here that popped up that was just about, you know, audio entertainment. Where do we see it going in the future? I have to say, from the Audible perspective, of course, we're very excited. There's so much happening right now in audio, and it's such a great space to be in. So exciting, such exciting content coming out. I'd love to hear, you know, quick answers from you. Audio entertainment, would you do it again? And where do you see it in the future?
Yeah, I'd love to do more stuff like that. I'd love to find the people that are interested in a more challenging story, and also that, as we've been saying, that want to get lost and found in sound, because our mind is able to create spaces with just sound and sound effects. So I'm excited, and I hope that we have people that are willing to go there with us.
Yeah, I would totally do it again, but I would pray for the opportunity to do it 95% in person with the cast and in the studio, and save the 5% for like some amazing talent that is, you know, like Teresa, who was in Mexico, and we were able to like, you know, record her there, or uplift, who was Miami, but that would only be 5% of the reality of doing an audio production, so that we could have the just the extra magic that happens as creators together.
Mm-hmm. Teresa, any thoughts on audio entertainment, where it might be headed?
Well, I read a lot, and what I think back in, I don't know, I had an Audible account for many, many years. And when I discovered it, it was like one of my biggest, the greatest things that ever happened to me, because I was able to drive or go places. Like I use Audible a lot more for books and things that I have to read. It's just incredible to be able to, also my mind focuses better when I'm doing something and then listening, because I'm more of a multitasker. So I think that it's an incredible tool that we have now. And I hope that it keeps growing, and that every book can be read and voiced. I really like it.
That's great. And Adelina, not to push that aside, for so many reasons, we hope that we can be in person more, right? Just to put what has been the last year behind us, where I think we're headed in the right direction.
Yeah, I think so too. And to your point about just thinking of this conference and the work that, you know, Anna and all of you have been doing, I hope the future of Audible is all of us. I want to binge on Latinx, Latina stories, and I go through Audible searching for our cuentos. So my hope is that Audible, demographic-wise, catches up where we are headed, because we have incredible historias to tell.
Also more translations of the great books. I think that we are missing a lot of, there's incredible books that you can only find in English. So it'd be really great if they could be translated to Spanish, so it could, you know, be more available.
Yeah, it's definitely a journey for sure. And something mm-hmm. I know that Audible's dedicated to. So you should see more of all of that coming out. It's a unique place. It's truly, truly dedicated to that in our principles and the fiber. So stay tuned. There'll be more to come. I believe we're over time. Thank you all so much for joining us. It's been such a pleasure to talk with you all. Fantastic mujeres.
And thank you.
Has a
thank you.
Fabulous evening. Buenas noches.